Welcome to this time of worship at Trinity United Methodist Church. I'm Reverend Linda Tice, and I am so glad to welcome all of you here, and for our friends at home, we are so especially glad that you're with us. So, as we gather today, we join our hearts together, we join our souls together, and recognizing the importance of worshiping God and how God anchors us as we go forward. So I invite you to now to enter into this time of worship, opening your heart and saying, "Here we are."
Thank you.
Today is the fifth Sunday, and in the Florida Conference, it is a Sunday in which we take up a collection for the United Methodist Children's Home. You need to know this is just a passion of mine, the Children's Home. I was on the board for 9 years and just saw so many children's lives change, and children who found God and the love of Christ through each of you and so many other people. And so each fifth Sunday, we will take up a collection for the Children's Home. I wanted to let you know, just last week, one of the marketing directors was in the area, and she called me, and we got together to catch up a little, because I was wondering how things were doing there with the COVID. And as you can imagine, churches not gathering has hurt the Children's Home. And she said that they were barely made. The only reason that they made their bills last year was because they received a large donation right at the very last day of the year, 2021. So it is vital that every church does their part, and I thank you for your faithfulness. I wanted you to get to know a little bit of that. So we have a clip here. This is one of the foster runner, the parents in the home that takes care of the kids there. And I just wanted you to hear from her a little bit.
Everybody would ask me when I was little, how many children would you like to have? And I would always say, 8. And it's like, no, you're crazy. You're not going to have that many kids. I said, I want 8 kids. My name is Sharon Dupe. Me and my husband are foster care parents living here in one of the cottages on the campus at the children's home. What led me to want to foster children is when I was 5 years old. My mom, she had mental health issues. She was put into a hospital for a few months, and my dad was trying to take care of 4 children and work and support our family, and he didn't have time to take care of us. So they ended up placing us in a home. I get to watch these kids coming in our home, not sleeping at night, afraid of where they're going to be, to being a part of our family. If they were living on the streets or in, you know, having hard times, they wouldn't have that idea of what a family really is. And in our home, we make sure we set the goals as I want these children to see what family life is. What is it like to have people that care for them or understand them, that it's okay to make mistakes and it's okay to, you know, get up and brush yourself off and move forward, and you have somebody to support you and help you understand what you've been through. The best part about being a foster parent is having these kids come up to you and tell you they love you and they thank you for what you're doing for them and making sure that, you know, their needs are met. We want to thank you, because without your help, none of this would be possible.
Circle envelope envelopes in the back by the donation boxes if you would like to make a donation. You can take it, bring it by the office anytime. And for those of you at home, you can give online. But we thank you for your... Would you join me in prayer as we pray for our offering today? Gracious God, we thank you for the generosity of all your people, for the generosity for the ministries of this church, as well as for our children's home. We pray, Lord, that you will bless them in the giving, but most of all, that we can see the fruit of our work through you. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
Would you pray for me as I pray for you? Come, Holy Spirit, fill the hearts of your faithful everywhere. Open our hearts and our minds to hear the particular message that you have for each one of us today. And I pray, Lord, that the words I say are not my own, but are yours. Amen. I want to read you two statements from Tom Berlin. We've been talking about courage these last few weeks, and I want you to hear what he says about this. So friends are the means of grace God has used to carry us through the difficult times. Let me read it again. Friends are the means of grace God uses to carry us through the difficult times. And friends believe for us when we cannot find a way to believe for ourselves. Friends believe for us when we cannot find a way to believe for ourselves. What will we do without friends? What will we do without them? As we talk about courage these last few weeks, this is an important aspect that we need to look at. It's the courage we get from friends as we walk this path of faith. Our friends are very important to how we receive God and how we show God to others. And so our scripture today talks about the role of friends, about some friends helping each other. And again, we are going to the book of Luke, looking at some of the stories of Luke to tell to us about courage. In Luke 5, one day, Jesus was teaching, and Pharisees and teachers of the law were sitting there. They had come from every village of Galilee and from Judea and Jerusalem. And the power of the Lord was with Jesus to heal the sick. Some men came carrying a paralyzed man on a mat and tried to take him into the house to lay him before Jesus. When they could not find a way to do this because of the crowd, they went up on the roof and lowered him and his mat through the tiles into the middle of the crowd, right in front of Jesus. When Jesus saw their faith, he said, "Friend, your sins are forgiven." The Pharisees and the teachers of the law began thinking to themselves, "Who is this fellow who speaks blasphemy? Who can forgive sins but God alone?" Jesus knew what they were thinking and asked, "Why are you thinking these things in your hearts? Which is easier, to say your sins are forgiven, or to say, get up and walk? But I want you to know that the Son of God has authority on earth to forgive sins." So he said to the paralyzed man, "I tell you, get up, take your mat, and go home." Immediately he stood up in front of them, took what he had been lying on, and went home praising God. Everyone was amazed and gave praise to God. They were filled with awe and said, "We have seen a remarkable thing today." Friends, can you picture that image? Friends carry us through difficult times. Do you agree with that? Friends carry us through difficult times. We had here a group of friends that wanted to get this paralyzed man in to see Jesus. They had heard he was in town. They'd heard about this healer. And so they brought him, but the crowd around the house was too big, and they couldn't carry him in to the middle. And so not to be daunted, they went up to the outside, and usually there's an outside staircase where people can go up on the top of a roof, often to sleep at night because it's too hot inside. But it's a small thing, so still getting him up those stairs was no easy task. But they got up to the roof, and they began to move tiles and thatch and whatever was there keeping the roof on, the mud, and they began to move it. Well, think about what's going on inside. Jesus is teaching, and everybody's listening to him, and all of a sudden somebody feels a little something falling on the shoulder, a little dirt, a little mud, and they start to see some dust coming down. And next thing they know, a big tile has been moved, and it's been opened. The debris is starting to rain down, and then a man is lifted and carried, or is lifted down. This is called a theatrical entrance. This is not a subtle, let's just slide him in there, nobody will notice. This was a full force, everybody's going to be aware of what we're doing. Bringing this man to Jesus. Have you thought about the owner of the house? I thought about that. What was that like for them? I imagine they're really sort of excited to have Jesus at their house, and all these Pharisees and people, all these people have come to their house to see Jesus. So they're probably feeling pretty good about it. And then all of a sudden, they start to see the debris, they start to see a hole in their roof, an unwanted sky window. So were they frustrated and angry? Or were they excited about the determination of these friends to get somebody to Jesus? Excited to see what was going to happen? I don't know. We don't really know. What the story tells us, though, is that we need each other in our Christian walk. We need to be together with Christian friends if we're to follow Jesus. Because this is not an easy walk that we're being asked to take. To follow Jesus means that we have to be ostracized, that people aren't going to agree, that they'll think we're weird as Jesus people, that we may lose friends, non-Christian friends. We're called to see the world in a different way. We're called to see the world through Jesus' eyes. We're called to live the values that Jesus teaches us that are not necessarily the values of the world. We're called to be a visible reminder for people of who Jesus is. We need each other. We need each other to support us and carry us through these difficult times. And that's where this whole idea of courage comes in. We need each other to stay courageous in our faith walk. Because non-Christians don't understand. They don't understand what it is to be called. To walk in a different way. And even sometimes Christians don't have the same idea of what that means. We have to have the courage to be visible in our faith, which isn't easy. And we have to have the courage to talk with each other, to fair to say, oh my gosh, it was so hard. I had a chance to sort of say something to somebody about Jesus, and they snubbed me. And that really hurt. I was embarrassed. To be able to share the disappointments and the celebrations. Oh, I just had to call you and tell you. I was so excited. I was talking to somebody about Jesus. They saw my cross and they made a comment. And I just shared with them that Jesus is important to me. And they started talking about how they wanted to know Jesus. It was exciting. And I just needed to tell somebody who would understand. We need those Christian friends to walk with us in this journey. And we need Christian friends to talk about some of the things we struggle with. When we gather with Christian friends, we don't all agree on the same thing. We don't have the same idea of where we should go, what we should do. We don't have the same interpretation of what it means. But being a part of Christian friends means that we can talk with each other, have conversation, wrestle with things together, agree to disagree, and yet stay focused on the truth of Christ and where we're called to walk as Christians. We need each other in that walk. Think about during the pandemic. We're still in it, but think about how long has it been now? Seems like it just goes on, doesn't it? Think about when we were so isolated. Think about when you couldn't be around friends. Think about that time that where you just felt like you, it was you and your faith. You were doing your daily readings, maybe you were online worshiping. I think the pandemic reminded us how much we need each other. It reminded us of the danger of isolation of faith. The need for conversation and wrestling together reminded us of how we serve God together. We serve together. Courage comes when we are come together. And I'm not talking necessarily physically, but when we are together as one in mind and body and focused on what our goal is through Jesus, we find the courage of each other helps us to move forward. Last week I was at a district meeting and we had a gentleman that was talking about one of my passions. You've heard about one of the passions as a children's home. There's four things that you're going to hear me talk about probably a lot. I'll just warn you up. Children's Home, Encore. There's a ministry in Orlando called iDignity, and Zoe. Zoe is a ministry that, all four of those are ministries that I see change lives right immediately. All in the name of Jesus. Zoe is a ministry that was started a while ago during the AIDS epidemic in Africa when so many children were left as orphans. The AIDS epidemic just killed so many people. And then it was genocide that killed parents. And now it's COVID that's killing parents. And there are millions of children in Africa and other places in the world, but Zoe is right now focused on Africa and India, where there are children raising children. There's nobody else. And Zoe just briefly brings those children together, makes them into households, and helps teach them a trade so that they can get out of poverty, can make a living, can go to school, and can become leaders in the community eventually. There was a girl that Gaston was talking about this week. She was 12 years old when her parents died, and she had four siblings that she was to take care of. The uncle left the house to them but took the land that was to be theirs. And she tried to get it back through the years and never could. Developed a successful Zoe business, was productive, cared for the children, became a great part of the community. But yet she could never get her land back. And she was with a bunch of other Zoe kids one time that they gathered, just sort of complaining that she needed that land to grow her business. They said, well, why don't you have it? Well, the local authorities sided with my uncle. They won't give it to me. So when she was 19, and she was with this group, they said, well, we're going to take care of this. And they called Zoe and people from all around the area. There were hundreds of people from this town and other communities that came to this community to stand with her, to go up to the magistrate to demand that he give her her land back that was hers. And with all these people, she had community around her supporting her. And the magistrate said, okay, and gave her her land back. It reminds me of the power of being together, the power of staying focused on what God calls us to do. We feel courage when we have that community of faith around us. It's easier to face obstacles when we're shoulder to shoulder with people and not feeling like we're out on our own. Courage is staying connected to each other and to the power of Jesus. Because there is power in the name of Jesus, amen? And when we stay connected to it, we find that power. But it's hard to do. The walk that Jesus calls us to walk is not an easy walk. And it's getting harder and harder to walk. Because Christianity is not the popular thing so much anymore. People believe in Jesus, but they don't want to be part of the church. And so it is harder for us to walk forward. And we need each other. We need the power of Jesus to help us walk through those difficult times. It's friends that carry us into that power. Well, the other things friends do is they will help us believe when our belief has gotten waning. When we can't find a way to get back to our belief. And we've all been there. We've all had times where we've just been hit by life or we're so isolated that our belief in Jesus takes a battering, that maybe the doubts grow. And we need other people to help us find a way back to Jesus, to remind us of the power of Jesus until we can do it for ourselves again. For those times when life has paralyzed us, and we can't move, but we need friends to carry us to Jesus, to pray with us. Pray with us when we're feeling damaged and drained. We've all been there. We've all been there. is on your team? Who is on your team that is carrying you? We all have teams around us. Who's on your team? Think about the people that carried the paralyzed man. Somebody had to have the idea. Somebody that was the idea person to say, hey, let's take him to Jesus. We don't know if he was a believer or just somebody curious had heard about Jesus and wanted to see what would happen. I don't know. But somebody came up with the idea first and sparked the discussion. Who is your idea person around you that says, hey, what about? Why don't we? And then every group needs an encourager. There had to be somebody in that group carrying the man when they started talking about it and got daunting, or they ran into the crowds that said, oh my gosh, and they start, I don't know that we can do this. There's that encourager says, yeah, we can. We can figure out how to get around this. We can do this. Who's your encourager? And then you've got to have muscle. There was somebody that had to help lift that man up onto the roof. Who's your muscle? That muscle is that person with that get up and go that says, okay, enough discussion. I'm picking him up. Let's go. I'm picking you up. We're going. No more staying home. I'm picking you up. Get ready. I'll be there at 2. Who's your muscle? And then every group also will have a naysayer. A naysayer is that person who doesn't necessarily say no, but is that hesitant. That maybe throws out some of the possibilities you need to think about a little bit. Well, what would happen if, and I don't know, we may run into the problems with this. They're the cautious. And the naysayers are okay as long as everybody listens to some of the caution, weighs it. So yeah, we maybe need to think about an alternative with this. Or, yeah, I know, I hear you, but no, we're going. Who is your team around you that carries you when you're paralyzed, when you get stuck? When we are walking toward Jesus and united in Jesus, we become one. And that is the key, is for us friends of Christ. We stay united in Jesus. Whether we agree or not, we're all working towards the same goal of taking people to Jesus. Carrying that message of hope to all people. Overcoming differences, uniting in Christ. You know, I have to take a wonder real quick about the man on the stretcher. Did he have any say in this? You know, did they just come pick him up and say, we're going to see Jesus? Or maybe it was his idea and he begged them to take him. But, you know, what was his role in this? He had to be a little vulnerable with it. Maybe he was excited. Maybe he was apprehensive. Maybe he felt very helpless. Maybe he was embarrassed, you know, being let down in the middle of everybody. A lot of times what that man is sometimes us as we walk with friends with lots of different emotions. We need our friends when we're paralyzed by life, when we can't pray, when we can't take those steps for Jesus. We need our friends. And when we are to be the examples in the community, we need to go together. Because it feels better to be walking forward with friends on each side. And that is our goal, to be friends in Christ and to tap into that power of Jesus. And that's what Christianity means for each one of us to do. To teach, to help Christianity thrive. That is our job as followers of Jesus. And it's interesting. Jesus healed the man first. Did you hear that in the scripture? He healed him first. That inner transformation. And then when Pharisees started giving him a lot of dust, he said, okay, now get up and walk. Take your cup and walk out. Jesus brings transformation so that we can walk forward into whatever it is, the task that Jesus has for each of us to do. One final thought. Friends are there to celebrate. Can you imagine what happened when he walked outside that building? And the guys came down from the steps and they met out in the courtyard? Can you imagine the celebration that went on? The high five. You know, when we celebrate by ourselves, it's okay. But celebrating with other people is a whole lot more fun. I want to read those lines that I started with again. Friends are the means of grace that God uses to carry us through difficult times. Friends believe for us when we cannot find a way to believe for ourselves. Thank you. Thank you, God, for the courage of friends. Let's pray. For Jesus, you call us to go forward. We have such a task in front of us of sharing your message, of being visible examples of who you are and why you make a difference in individual lives and in the community. Oh, but we need each other, Lord. The tasks that are in front of us seem so daunting and scary. But you give us friends that work together, come together, so that all tasks can be accomplished. Help us to be that friend to others, Lord. Help us to get excited about the possibilities. Amen. Thank you. Please be seated. I want to invite T to come up. Today is T's last Sunday with us. She has been here with us for 4 years as our Director of Congregational Care. Come on, the camera needs to see you up here. Sorry. And her husband George in partnership all the time. And so today we celebrate their ministry here with us as she has cared for so many of you and so many that have walked those difficult journeys as we talk about being a friend. And we are very grateful for all that she has done for us. And we have a gift here from the church. A scarf with you and something to buy some books with, because we hope you'll have some time to read a little bit right now. But we are so grateful for T and just her heart that she has shared with us, and thank you for that. And I felt that when I came here, I haven't been here that long, that you made me feel immediately welcome and part of the team, and I'm very grateful for your friendship that you've given me. So. Can you say thank you? And those of you online can say your thank you in the chat. But I'm going to ask T to give the benediction and say whatever you want to say. Afterwards, we're going to invite T and George to be out in the courtyard area. We are going to ask you not to hug, okay? I know you want to give her a big hug, but she has twins on the way. Her son is going to have twins, and we want to protect her and protect them. So we're going to ask you to share your love from a distance.
Being a witness, a small work for me, great courage, and immense ability to plan the life. Up into their lives, their movies, they didn't let that number discourage them. I want you to imagine a balcony, and there they were cheering you on. So when you think of the great kind of witnesses, allow yourself the names of friends, folks that were in Bible study, assembly, generation, because they fully gave us a witness. And we were all married to them. So I'm going to give you a different place to live. But when you forget for a moment, I'm happy to share with you some of the tiny things that were your companions that cheer you on from above. Now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord lift his countenance upon you and fulfill the space all around you with grace. May the Lord lift his face upon you and give you peace and joy. Amen.
So please join us out in the courtyard. We've got cupcakes that you can take and eat. So please enjoy us in the celebration. Thank you.